In this lesson, we're going to take a look at ionic compounds and ionic bonding, which is the bonds between cations and anions, or positively and negatively charged ions. So take a look at this cartoon. We have this little atom here that's offering his electron. When he loses the electron, he's going to become positively charged, which would make him the cation, and this one gaining the extra electron would become the anion. So ionic compounds, we have two major types of ionic compounds. The first type are called binary compounds. Now, bi implies two, and binary compounds is when there are only two elements present, a metal and a non-metal. So for example, sodium chloride or lithium oxide. You have one single cation and one single anion. The other type are polyatomic compounds, poly meaning multiples. So polyatomic compounds include an ion with more than one type of atom in them, such as calcium sulfate or ammonium sulfide. If you look here, this sulfate is the polyatomic ion, and ammonium here is the polyatomic ion. Multiple atoms as a part of a single ion. So if we want to look at that sulfate, what that actually looks like is you have four elements here that are actually covalently bound to each other, but as a whole, they count as an ion with a negative two charge. So you would have the calcium binding to the sulfate as a whole, as a single entity or an ion. Here's some other common polyatomic cations and anions. There's really only one common cation. There are multiple polyatomic anions. Ionic bonding occurs because the cation is positive and the anion is negative, and opposites attract. So there is an attraction between the positives and negatives. Now we have to remember when that happens, we don't just have one cation and one anion joined together. We actually have a large number of them joining together, as depicted by this image here, which is an example of traditional table salt, sodium chloride. So to make up salt, you actually have thousands of cations and anions, which all arrange themselves to make sure that there are positive negative attractions between them. Ionic compounds always have a charge of zero. So when we have our non-metal fluorine here and our metal calcium, if we take a look, these are Lewis dot diagrams, fluorine having seven valence electrons, calcium having two. Calcium wants to give one away, fluorine will take that. However, calcium still has one more electron to give, so it needs another fluorine to give that to, otherwise it would remain charged. So in order to make sure that we have a net charge of zero, sometimes you need multiple cations or anions to balance out the charges. So in this case, fluorine, by gaining electron, would have a negative one charge, each one a negative one, and calcium would have a positive two, so our formula would be CaF2. Take a look at aluminum and oxygen. Oxygen can take two of the electrons from aluminum. Aluminum still has one more to give, so you draw another oxygen. Oxygen can take one, but that oxygen still needs another, so you draw yet another aluminum. It gives one of that oxygen. That second aluminum still has two more to give, so you would draw another oxygen in order to have net charge. So you would have an aluminum, when it loses its three electrons, would have a positive three charge, and the oxygens, when they gain two, would each have a negative two charge. But if you added those up, two plus threes give you an overall of positive six, and we have two, four, six negatives, you would have a neutral compound. So properties of ionic compounds, because the positive and negative attraction between cations and anions is relatively strong, as compounds, they are hard, they are brittle, and they have very high melting points because they stick together. In order to melt, you have to break them apart, and they don't break apart very easily. However, some are soluble in water because what happens, and indicated in this diagram up here, is water is polar, meaning that it's partially charged, and its charges actually attract to the cations and anions, and it can literally pull them apart. So they are soluble or can dissolve in water. Those dissolved ionic compounds conduct electricity and are called electrolytes, very common in batteries. So when you put salt in water, it breaks down into its sodium and chloride ions, and they are floating around individually. And because they are charged, they can then pass current of electricity through them and are known as electrolytes. So how do we name compounds? The first thing you have to do is you write your cation or your metal first. Think of it as going left to right across a periodic table. Whatever shows up on the left side of the periodic table will also show up on the left side of your names. So if it's just a metal, you write down the name of the metal. Some metals, however, will need a Roman numeral after it because some metals have several different charges they could take. They are known as multivalent. So a Roman numeral will indicate the charge, whether it is a plus one, two, three, or four charge. So copper two would be written as copper, Roman numeral two. Lead four plus would be written as lead IV. If it's a polyatomic ion, such as ammonium, you would just write the word or the name ammonium. The second part of naming the ionic compound is the anion or the non-metal written second. You take the root name of that non-metal and add the word IDE. So oxygen would become oxide, fluorine, fluoride, carbon becomes carbide. Okay? If it's a polyatomic that's occurring second, you just write the name of the polyatomic ion, nitrate, chlorate, oxide, cyanide. So pause the video now and give the following a try. Let's see how you did. First one, you should have beryllium fluoride. Then iron 2 phosphide because iron is a multivalent atom. Make sure that you check your periodic table or that need to know list to know which ones are multivalent. You should have aluminum oxide, potassium sulfide, tin 2 carbonate, again, a multivalent ion, so you have to make sure you write the Roman numerals, and ammonium sulfate. So how is it that we come up with the formulas? The basis of that is the crisscross rule. So the crisscross rule simplifies the fact that you can take the ionic charge to determine the number of each atom in a compound. Once you do the crisscross rule, you always have to simplify to the lowest common denominator. So let's take the example of bonding between beryllium and nitrogen. So beryllium, to make an ion, will lose two electrons and becomes beryllium 2 plus ion. Nitrogen gains three electrons and becomes nitride. So we would write the element symbol with the charge up top, beryllium 2 plus, nitrogen with the 3 minus. You take that charge and you cross it over. And you cross it over to the other one. So the three comes down here. Notice you drop the positive and the negative sign, just the number crosses over. So that three comes down beside the beryllium, the two down beside the nitrogen, and it would become beryllium nitride. Okay, pause the video now and give a try for copper one oxide and tin two oxide. Let's see how you did. Okay, copper had a charge of plus one. It told you that by the Roman numeral. Oxygen as an ion has a charge of negative two. When you bring that two down to the copper and the one down to the oxygen, it becomes Cu2O. Note, you don't write the one because the fact that you have the element symbol there implies that there is one atom. Tin, in this case, was tin plus two, so you wrote tin plus two. Oxygen negative two. You bring the twos down, would be SN2O2. Notice you do have to reduce them to SNO. So, what about formulas with polyatomic ions? You write the formula of the cation, including the charge. Then you write the formula of the ion, including the charge. Follow the same crisscross rule. However, when you crisscross, that number that you're bringing down applies to the entire polyatomic ion. So, every atom within that polyatomic ion will be multiplied by that number. Okay? You reduce the subscripts. So, for example, if we have lead with a charge of 2 plus and hydroxide as a polyatomic ion has a 1 negative, that 1 comes down to the lead, the 2 comes over to the hydroxide. But since we need 2 of that entire ion, we put it in parentheses or brackets. So notice it comes down over here. Remember, the 1 disappears and it would become PB bracket OH bracket 2. Give these a try and we'll come back and check your answers. How did you do? Calcium sulfide, CaS. Sodium nitride, NaNO3. AlPO4 for aluminum phosphate. Iron 3 carbonate becomes Fe2 bracket CO3 bracket 3 because you need three of the entire carbonate ion. And aluminum carbonate, sorry, ammonium carbonate is NH4 bracket 2 CO3.